Okay, so today is one of the surgical webinar which is going to deal with the commonest surgical technique that we will ever do in our spine surgery career. I am sure we all not only do it better, a little better, but also despite having learned it better, it's only time, periods. The more we do, the more we learn. Even today, when we have the best of the best in the country going to talk to us about spinal instrumentation, take my word that even today, 1 out of 100 perforations may still be happening in the best hands. And that's very small and meager number if only one perforation rate in your pectoral screw for a period of 5 years, at the end of 10 years. We have all seen problems with pectoral screw instrumentations. We have all seen problems of extra osseous or misplacement of pectoral screws, both in lumbar spine, in thoracic spine, and in lateral mass fixation also. We have all seen critical issues of neurological deficits happening, post-operative radiculopathies happening, burst out happening, implant loosening happening, purely because of surgical technical errors, purely because we have not been following the surgical principles in sacral screws. If you don't get a bicortical purchase, no matter how good a convergence you have got, no matter how thick a screw you have put, the chances of screw loosening, particularly in multi-segmental fixation, is really, really high. In a patient where single level interbody fusion is done, what if you get a L5 screw perforated intraoperatively? And many simple questions we are going with today in our talk, and our stalwarts with us are there today to help us understand the basic principles of this. Just give me a minute, please. Just to begin with, let me introduce my panelists and the moderators for the day. I'm Dr. Vishal. I'm going to be with you today to ask questions to all the speakers and panelists on the common problems, tips, tricks, and principles of spinal instrumentation. We have already had a detailed discussion on spinal biomechanics in the webinar. We already had some of these speakers speaking upon the tips, tricks, and salvage options. However, today we are going to take every single surgery in spinal instrumentation in greatest possible details. All the questions that you have in your mind, all the problems you have faced till date while doing pectoral instrumentation, be it in lumbar spine, be it in sacral spine, be it in thoracic spine, or posterior lateral mass instrumentation. Please reflect on the problems that you faced. Please start thinking about the issues that you faced while doing thoracic screw, lumbar screw, sacral screw instrumentation. With all these problems, we are going to be checking upon our panelists for the day, Dr. Sameer Dalvi, who is a consultant spine surgeon and a very senior member of the Spine Society and Association of Spine Surgeons of India. He's going to be talking to us about the technique of lumbar and sacral pectoral screw fixation system. We have Dr. Amit Sharma, who's going to be discussing with us about various techniques of getting absolutely intraosseous placement of thoracic pectoral screws, both in a straight spine. And also we'll be discussing about how to put thoracic pectoral screw in a rotated spine or a deformed spine. And then we have none other than Dr. Sandeep Sonone, one of the pioneers in cervical spine surgery, very senior member of Bombay Spine Society from KEM Hospital, to talk about lateral mass screw insertion techniques, right from incision to exposure to placement to post-op rehab, and also precautions and post-op assessment of lateral mass fixation. With us today, we are really blessed to have Dr. Ingal Halikar sir joining us. We'll be taking his help and his experience of all these years of pectoral screw instrumentation and problems that he has seen. We also have with us Dr. Vishal Peshattivar from Ambani Hospital joining us. We have with us Dr. Guru Raj. We have with us Dr. Neeraj Vasavada. And also we are going to soon be joined by Ranjit Unnikrishnan. So let me welcome you all the panelists. Thank you so much for sparing your time. We are joined with more than 600 delegates at this point in time, other than Zoom on YouTube and Facebook, seeing this webinar. Let's make it fruitful for them. Just to make it worst case scenario and to set the background right, I'm bringing to you a patient of 38-year-old male with incomplete neurology, unfortunately, after surgery, became complete paraplegic. What went wrong? Post-operative weak patient who had only degenerative LCS, again, in one of the very, very senior surgeon's hands, what went wrong? In a patient with degenerative spondylolisthesis, patient having no neurology before surgery, after surgery woke up with both lower limb weakness. Again, something could have been prevented, but went wrong purely because of intraoperative issues related to implant. What went wrong in these patients? The only thing that went wrong in these patients was a screw. We all know that these problems are going to be seen by all of us in future. We are going to see instabilities which are already present, like in patients with fracture, listhesis, infections, tumors, all patients who are going to have imminent instability intraoperative to wide laminectomies. We all also know complex anatomical structures surrounding these bones where these screws are supposed to be going. There are various things to see. There are various complex anatomical relations which can be disastrous if the screws are not placed well. There are studies to say that 23% screws, when assessed by CT scans in the hands of mediocre, oblique, specialized spine surgeons, this study comes way back in 1999, and the perforation rates have not grossly changed when assessed by CT scans, though most of them may not be neurologically causing any problem. However, perforation rates even today in the best hands range from 9 to 16%. Yes, we are lucky that only 1 to 3% develop neurological problems post-operatively. And that is why this webinar today is not about to make you learn how to insert pedicle screw, but to make you learn how to insert pedicle screw in the pedicle and also safely. So let us start with the lumbar and sacral pedicle screw insertion by none other than Dr. Sameer Dalvi. Dr. Sameer Dalvi, over to you, sir. Dr. Dalvi?
Yeah, I'm there.
Perfect. So, Dr. Dalvi, while your slides are being pulled out, what is the incidence in your practice in last 1,000 cases? How many times would you have gone in to revise your screws post-operatively? We are talking about post-operative revision, that symptomatic misplacement of screws. Has it ever happened to you?
Yeah, of course it has happened to me. I would say... I think maybe 0.5, 1 in 200 cases maybe.
Right. I think that's something that's really, really important to understand, that 0.5 to 1% patients they have revised. So doctor, do you think that in that particular case you didn't use SIAM, or you'd seen in SIAM also, but it showed something and it became something? I mean, what could have been the reason that you were not able to pick it up intraoperatively?
I think whatever method you use, I think whether you use freehand, whether you use SIAM, whether you use navigation, electrophysiology, and we'll come to that. Whatever method you use, there is no method which is 100% foolproof, you know. And no matter what is your experience or what is not your experience, you can cut down errors. I don't think there's anybody in the world who can say 100% the screw will go in the pedicle, including robot. Like, I think robot has got margins of error. And so each one has their own system of error. Each one has a different type of error which can happen for it to fail. So whatever is my method is free hand plus C-arm, C-arm has its own level of failure. So sometimes C-arm, you know, the visualization is not good, the pedicle is not seen properly.
Right.
You know? And sometimes, you know, it's like they say there is a Marathi saying, not a Hindi one, that the bad dancer blames the floor. So I can't even translate that. But sometimes what happens is that the vertebra is very funny. So I have had in two patients, I have had medial perforations where the vertebra is extremely funny. It's like the L5 is a lot like the sacrum, and it's a very steeply convergent sort of thing. So it's very difficult to get an entry point, and only in a CT scan can you see that it has gone medially, you know?
Right.
So
right.
I've had a couple of those cases as well, which I've done.
Right. Dr. Dalvi, so now you are already 25 years old, only in spine surgery. Mm-hmm. And would you please enlighten us, has over a period of years, you have seen that your perforation rates have come down, like when you started versus after 5 years of your practice versus after 10 years of your practice, has your incidence overall?
So there is something very funny, which I don't know whether what the fact is, but when I was in KEM and we used to do them only with lateral C-arm, We use only a lateral, not CM, lateral X-ray. I don't remember revising even one. Now, I don't know whether the reason was that we never bothered to ask the patient for symptoms or whether genuinely we were always right because we never took APs.
Right.
After I started taking APs in the middle, that the thing was out. But I wouldn't say that in my last 20 years that my rate has gone up or down. It's not even gone down. I still, have my fair share of...
Right. So do you feel that there's a learning curve involved into this? Like there are so
but
young...
It also depends on what screw you're talking about, right? Now, the lumbar screws, which you're talking about here, right? Which is my topic, my present topic.
Yes.
For lumbar screws, the learning curve really isn't much. I mean, it's a very tiny learning curve. We do so many much more complicated procedures that putting a lumbar screw is not a deep learning curve, for sure.
Right.
As you go to thoracic, the learning curve is maybe steeper, but the forgiveness is slightly more. It's very odd. But a thoracic screw slightly malplaced, unless you whack the aorta, is, doesn't cause so much of a problem.
Right.
So maybe, you need to learn. But I honestly think that given the amount of procedures which are there out in spine surgery today, learning to put a pedicle screw is not all that complicated. It doesn't have a steep learning curve.
Right.
It's that typical old story of C1, assist one and do one.
Right. I think this is something that is the sum of the day. Let's catch up on Dr. Dalvi to show one. So we learn one and from tomorrow can start doing one whenever the lockdown is over. Over to you, Dr. Dalvi. Please start.
So anyway, this talk, in case it's the same audience has been a little given before, I'll try to emphasize different points in it because we had one implant session as well. Basically, I think we shouldn't start anything without the history. And it's actually Paul Harrington in the 60s who put the first pedicle screw and he tied it with a wire to a Harrington rod. But Roy Camille in France made it more popular and he used it with a round hole plate. And then in the 1980s, Arthur Steffi then used this VSP plate, which has a variable screw placement, which I'll show. And in fact, Dr. Lahiri, and in the last seminar, someone told me that Dr. Lahiri also put his first in the 1980s, like even before Art Steffi started putting pedicle screws. So that's our history for India. And we go from strength to strength. The reason we use the pedicle screw, we know by now, it really is one of the strongest holds on the vertebra because it goes through the fourth nucleus, which is a junction of three elements. And you actually go through all the three columns. You're really fixing all three columns. A bilateral grip gives rise to a very good manipulation. And those of you who do VBR and all these similar material, type of surgeries know that it really, bilateral good grip gives you a solid grip for all sorts of manipulations and rotations. Now, longitudinally, initially, they were using simple plates, but later on went on to these VSP plates. So VSP plates are those where they had a nest to put the screw in, and the screw went in first and the plate went on top. So they had more variability of screw placement, but you could only contour them sagittally. So you could give kyphosis, lordosis, but you couldn't really put them in a scoliosis. And therefore the screw rod systems came, which were much, much more flexible. And now we all use rod system. I think most of you won't even know what a plate system is, but this was the original Steffi screw, which had a sort of a base plate, which sat on the bone. And then the plate sort of sat here. And then this nut, first nut and the second nut was put. And we used to use a Harrington rod cutter to cut off the tip. So maybe historical surgery for you, but we did lots and lots of these surgeries with this. And this was the VSP plate, which had these multiple nests. So we used to first put the screw, then this plate on top, and then tighten it with the nuts. So the plate was sandwiched between the screw and the nuts. Of course, you are all aware of this system now, which is the rod system. And first it started with this innie and outie, because what happened is that those which used only outies became too bulky, and those which used only innies, they became loose, because every time you tighten the innie, the tulip used to open up and the screw was loose. In fact, surprisingly, a company as big as Medtronic used to have their system, which was known as M10. And they sold loads of it and all of them were loose. So they had to withdraw that system. It was like a huge, slap in the face for them. But Jürgen Harms in Germany and Professor Schuffelbacher in Miami, they together devised this innie and outie system. And they, his system was known as MOS. And the system in, this one was known as Miami, of Schuffelbacher, and then they got together and then Depew sort of pushed it forward. And it had an innie and an outie which tightened against each other and allowed them to make the tulip thin. So this is what it, and so the innie and the outie tightened against each other and the rod. So that was a very good biomechanical principle. But then now they've got over with metal tightening and all those things. They've got over stuff. And now most of the systems have only an innie, I think. So the rod implant was much better because you could contour it in all sort of directions. Screws have become almost standardized now. And we talk about shaft and core diameter for the strength and then thread diameter for the pullout strength. But what is interesting are the type of threads, and different companies will talk to you about different sizes of threads. You know, they are variable threads. Some threads have got, you know, cortical here and sort of cancellous here. So they have this, what is known as a taper core. And some have these buttress threads, which go only in one direction and therefore can't come backwards. And each has their pros and cons, because some of the thing like the conical shaft is good, but if it backs out even slightly, then the screw becomes loose. And so given the fact that there are so many different types of threads, it obviously means that no one is perfect. The polyaxial screw was another important thing. Again, these are things which you are completely used to now, but the polyaxiality becomes very, very important to allow the rod and the screw to align to each other and for us to be able to put screws which are angled in a system. And this polyaxiality gave around 60 degrees of mobility in one plane. And the next thing was the reduction screw, again, which had these long ears like this, which can be gradually used to reduce. So this was initially designed for spondylolisthesis, but even for scoliosis and kyphosis correction, this is very useful because it gives you a gradual and controlled kind of correction. The loading mechanism is also important, but nowadays we use only top loading. So this slide is a bit moot. In the past, for AOUSS, we use side loading, which was very, very nice. And then some of them like Isola and Colorado actually had side connectors. So you guys don't know this because I've been through the evolution of these screws. You guys are using the finished product. But Colorado and this had, they had side connectors. I mean, you know, you put in the screws and then the rod all had side connectors and they were connected to the screw. It was quite an interesting system. So Moss Miami had this inner and outer mechanism. Coming to the technique, which really this today's show is all about, I think every surgery starts with the planning. So planning, indications, assessment of bone stock, assessment of biomechanics. I mean, this all comes much, much before even you think of taking the patient on the table. But actually, once you take the patient on the table, let's do this. So positioning is very important. And I always, for a fixation case, I always go in even before the patient is draped to see how the patient is positioned on the bolsters or on the frame. Make sure that an APC arm is possible. You know, you don't want to start the surgery and in the middle suddenly see that there's a big radiolucent, radio-opaque rod in the middle over there. And, you know, if in case your fellows do it, then this is what something your fellows should know, that make sure that the C-arm is, because you'll feel get very irritated if you're doing an L4-5 and suddenly there's a radio-opaque rod in the middle over there. So make sure that your C-arm is able to see everything. Make sure your abdomen is free and that you have the correct lordosis or whichever position it is that you need to have it in. See that your patient is not tilted to one side or the other. So, you know, go to the foot end and see all of that. And you really should be able to know, you should know what the position of the patient is when you start your surgery. Because if you just land up directly with a draped or an exposed spine, you may not know the direction of the patient. The exposure is very important. The reason is that we learn on bone models or in the cadaver. It doesn't mean workshop, it means actual surgery. Because in the bone model, it looks very simple. In the pictures, it looks very simple, but it's not that simple. So what you need to do is you need to do a very excellent exposure. And in fact, since you're anyway doing a fusion, your spine should look like a bone model. If your spine looks like a bone model or like a cadaveric exposed specimen, then you're good. Because you have to identify all the entry points. You can't take just one entry point. You need to take the help of multiple clues and entry points to get your entry point properly. And you should also ideally expose to the tips of the transverse process. There are many reasons for this. So I will give you three. Vishal, can you hear?
Yes, yes, sir.
Sorry, yeah, because again, I'm not getting feedback. So the reasons for exposing to the tips of the transverse process are three. I will give you three right now. One is that a fusion for the fusion. Second is for your retractors to sit. You know, for your retractors have to sit. So I'm giving you four now. One is for the retractors to sit, the muscles have to be. If you don't expose and you put your retractor will tear the muscle. The third reason is for you to able to converge your screws. For instance, if you're doing a so-called open surgery, and if your muscles are not dissected laterally, then at the time of putting the screw, automatically your hand will get diverged, as in your hand is pushed towards the middle and your pedicle probe gets diverged and your screw will cut out laterally. So to be able to converge also, you need to have an excellent exposure to the lateral. And the last reason would be for you at the end of your surgery to reposition the muscle over the implant and suture it in the midline. So I'm giving you four good reasons why your exposure has to be to the tip of the transverse process. Very, very important. Fusion, retractor, direction, and repositioning the muscles. You should be able to visualize the entry points very clearly. You also, of course, needless to say, like, the battle is often won in the beginning itself. So you need to study the x-rays and the CT scans well to see whether there are any anomalies, thinner pedicles, direction, any kind of issues. For a standard lumbar degenerative surgery, there may not be so many problems. But if you're doing anything slightly funny, then you really need to study the images. So how do you put a screw? You have to determine basically the entry point and the direction and the length and thickness. So these are the things which you have to see. And basically, this would be mostly the entry point. And it can be described by many ways. One is the mammillary process. So many of the lumbar vertebrae do have a mammillary process. And if they have a mammillary process, it's very beautiful. You just nibble it and you're right in it. But all lumbar vertebrae may not have a mammillary process. So essentially, you need to identify the facet joint for sure. You need to identify the transverse process for sure. And you need to identify the pars interarticulares for sure. So once you identify these things, you are able to get the entry point well. And the entry point literally is at the junction. It's the lateral border of the facet joint. It's at the base of the transverse process, the midpoint, and where the pars interarticular joins. And if all of these together join at a mammillary process, then it's, you know, you're done. Sone pe suhaga, you've got your entry point quite well. What about the orientation? The orientation also depends slightly on the entry point, and we'll come to that. Because if your entry point is medial, which means you're going through a facet, then it is more of a straight entry. And that happens that sometimes you like to remove the facet and go through the facet, you know, and that happens at the lower point of a fusion, especially if you're doing a TLIF, sometimes just the lower point of the facet is left. But if you want to save the facet and you have a lateral entry point, then your screw has to be more convergent. What about the rest of the direction? The most important part of the direction is that it should not hit the upper end plate. So if you have a standard entry point, it should be parallel. But if you have an inferior entry point, it may be going superior, but it should not hit the upper end plate because there is a risk that there may be disc degeneration in the upper disc. If you hit the upper, like if you hit this disc, there may be disc. If you're fusing this level and you hit this disc, there is no problem, but it will just look bad on x-rays. That's all. So that would be the direction. What about length? Length, because of the x-rays and parallax in the x-ray, your screw in the x-ray should never look till here. If the screw is still here, it means it is out, right? Because you know, this is the shadow of the anterior wall. So your in the x-ray, your screw should end somewhere around here, somewhere around 2/3 into the body. I am not very, very fussed about screw length in most cases, because I think 2/3 of the hold is in the pedicle itself and only 1/3 of the hold is in the vertebral body. So don't struggle to put in too longer a screw. If you're stressed, if you're not sure, put in the shot. And anyway, the screws are in increments of 5 millimeters. So you have to decide between a 40, a 45 and a 50. And most of the screws are 45, and in females or in sort of smaller, shorter people, it may be 40. So 40 to 45 are usually the screws. The diameter, usually 6 millimeter diameter, is well taken by our Indian population. Rarely, you know, in a huge character, you may land up with a 7 millimeter. And in the sacrum, you may land up with a 7 millimeter screw. What about the other direction? It depends on how the patient is lying. So, you know, there is no fixed direction. If somebody tells you that a screw is at this angle, X angle, you know, that L4 is straight and L5 is this, that's rubbish. It depends on how the patient is lying on the table and how that vertebra is on the table. So you have to assess it based on the intraoperative x-ray and your judgment and position sense. So then what is the procedure? The first thing is you need to identify the entry point, and then you need to decorticate that entry point. And many people use a burr to decorticate it. I use a nibbler to decorticate it initially. And when you decorticate or de-roof the entry of the pedicle, you start seeing some marrow. You then may want to use something like this, which is a sharp probe, but I'll show you a better one later on. And after that, having done that, you may put in a K-wire to just see whether you're right or wrong. And the other one is this, which is a probe. So I'll show you that in a better way. So now these are the instruments which you use nowadays, right? So this, the first awl, right, is a straight awl where this is very sharp, but this has got a base plate, as you can see here. So it will prevent it from perforating. And this gives you the initial pedicle entry point. And after that, you use these. So these, there can be two or three types. Like this is a straight one. The one which I showed you in the previous one, that is known as a Steffi awl. So Steffi's awl is slightly blunt and slightly curved in the middle, curved at the tip, and has a ball on top of it. And then the Lenki awl was sharper and more curved, the Lenki awl. And there's a reason for the Lenki awl, and I'm going to leave it to Amit Sharma to tell you how to use a Lenki probe, because it is chiefly designed for the thoracic spine. Following that, what you need is these ball tip probes, probes like this, which are ball tip. You may need a straight one and a slightly curved one. And this is used to feel the walls of the pedicle. And then there's a tap, which may be suitable. And of course, there's a screwdriver, which you all know. You need to verify it, and you verify it by the probe or the feel. So this tactile feel is the most important, and you need to, throughout the length of the vertebra, throughout the length of the hole, you need to feel the four walls, that is superior, inferior, medial, lateral, and then the base of the vertebra, like the floor of the vertebra. So if all of these are intact, then you are inside the vertebra for a good chance. Like I told you, there's nothing which is 100%, but this gives you a chance in a better way. If you feel it's wishy-washy in one of the places, means you're out. I always use a K wire and a C-arm. You know, sometimes in scoliosis, I may not, because it's difficult to interpret. But in a standard lumbar spine, I like to use K wire and C-arm. I mean, even I may be in, but I like to have good looking x-rays post-op as far as possible. I'll not hugely struggle, but if the, you know, if the initial K wire is bad, then I'd like to put in a better one. And of course, you use a C-arm, and then you may use other things as well. So to verify that the screw is not perforated, C-arm is one thing, and there's electrophysiology as well. So, you know, for that, you need your neuromonitoring people, and you check the impedance of the pedicle. So what they do is they you put in a screw, or you put in the K-wire or a thick guide wire, and you touch the tip of the guide wire, and they feel the impedance of that by taking the signals from the feet. And with that impedance, if that signal is leaking too much, it shows that into the nerve. If it's leaking into the nerve, it shows that it's a malplaced screw, and otherwise it's not. So this is a good technique of doing it. Another one was an ultrasonic one, which I only saw in, I only saw it on a stall, where it seems there's an ultrasonic probe, which as you hammer inside, the sound changes if it perforates. It gives a beep, 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 beep when the sound changes. I've never used it. It's just what I've seen in a stall. And of course, your various intraoperative 3D imagings would be slightly more precise. But of course, it gives a whopping load of radiation to the patient. And also, it would be like very expensive. I mean, if your hospital has an O-arm or a 3D C-arm, it's good. But if they don't, then of course, they don't have it. So these would be some of the ways of really figuring out how you can. And the other, last but not the least, if you're really, really desperate and you feel your screw is not right, you can always palpate the pedicle from inside. I mean, that is also another very foolproof way to see that at least your screw is not medially out. So this is a small video. You can see we've seen the entry point, and we've nibbled the beginning, and this is the probe which you put in, and you use a particular kind of force. You know, you don't hammer it or anything. You use a force to see it goes between the two walls. Having done that, at this stage, I usually put a K wire and a C arm. And if it is open, then you can also feel the medial part of this. So I often do it. If I've done the laminectomy first, you can feel the pedicle to make sure where you are. Then you use this awl. Now this awl, as you see, is used in this manner. It's like a gear shift mechanism. So with the gear shift mechanism, you go in, you tend to hold it in two hands and skittle along the wall of the vertebrae. And then you use this probe to feel the four walls and the floor. And having done that, if you want to take another C-arm at that stage, but I usually don't take another C-arm. I like to tap at least the beginning of the entry, because it gives you the right direction. And I tend to tap in most of the cases with a one size smaller. So a 5mm tap for a 6mm, because most of our screws are actually self-tapping. And once you start the direction, So I'm sorry, this video has a lot of background noise, because my edited video didn't was not compatible with Mac, right? So, yeah. Okay. So then you are putting the screw. I'll just see if this one also has the sacral screw. at the end of the this one doesn't have the sequel screw, I'm sorry. Anyway, so at the end of the procedure, you do take SIAM. So I don't think it's always good to take a SIAM at the end. You know, why do you want to have sort of a bad looking screw when you can help? Or why do you want to have a situation where because you didn't take a SIAM, you have to come to the OT the next day? So you might as well take a SIAM again. So the important relations which you have to understand are these, that inferior is the nerve root if you cut out inferiorly. If you cut out medially, it's the dura or again the nerve root. And if you go anteriorly, it's the vessels. And the best thing is not to err, though they say err, you can err laterally and superiorly, but best is not to err, because I've also had lateral cutouts which cause a sort of a poor hold and superior cutouts causing problem to the upper root. So it's better to not have any error at this stage. The other issue is the injury to the upper facet. So this, if the entry point is here, you are damaging the upper facet, which is an unfused facet. You're not fusing that facet. And you'd like to avoid that because then you'll get an adjacent level pain or adjacent level disease. So for that, your entry point has to be slightly inferior and lateral. So if you have your inferior or lateral entry point, then you won't damage the upper facet. But if your entry point is inferior and lateral, then your screw has to be superior and medial. So your screw has to be angled medially and your screw has to be angled superiorly. And this is known as up and in placement. So this up and in placement has another advantage, which means you can use a longer screw. The other advantage of the up and in placement is that it avoids what is known as a parallelogram effect. So the parallelogram effect is spared from if you are using this up and in placement. Now, what about the SIAM? I think I just put in this slide extra from last time. I think if you're looking at the SIAM, you should not just take a casual SIAM and say, ha, okay, and go ahead. Really, you need to study it well. So in that SIAM for an AP, you must make sure that your vertebra is a box, your pedicle is circular, and this nose is between the two eyes. You know, basically, you're looking that rotation should not be there. And this also should not be looking. It should be looking like a plate. It should not be looking like this, like a circle. As you see, this is not, the beam is not centered over this one. The beam is centered over this one or actually over this one, right? And in case you're doing percutaneous or whatever, you need to be able to figure out which is the pedicle and where you are. For instance, this may be a good entry point, a superior, in case you want to do a superior and lateral entry point at the depth. Same thing with the lateral x-ray. Your lateral x-ray should also show, it should not show a disc. It should not show a round thing. It should show just a square vertebra like this. Only then do you know, only then can you be sure that this is truly your inferior pedicle. So this is something which you need to know, that you know you should not perforate the inferior part of the pedicle, but you can only confirm that this is the inferior pedicle if this vertebra is like a box and if you're seeing only one pedicle. If you're seeing two pedicles, it means that there is you know, it's not parallel. Of course, in a scoliosis it would be different, but I'm just telling you in a normal SIAM. And the other point is that if you are taking sequential SIAMs, then what you need to understand is that when your this instrument is at the back of this vertebra, then in the AP, this tip should not have crossed the medial side. This shows you that it's not perforated medially. Am I understanding that when this is at the back of the vertebra, this in the AP should not be perforating through the medial side? That shows you for sure that you have not perforated medially, right? And when it is in this depth, when it is here, so this would be the correct depth, because any more than this would mean that it's perforating outside. And at this depth, yes, the tip can look slightly medial, but if it is crossed the midline, suppose your tip at this point has crossed the midline, again, that means you have perforated medially. So this would be what your screws would look like. And there you can see they're all different. This one has slightly lateral entry points, so I'm allowing them to converge. This is almost a good one, but this is a slightly medial entry point. So this is going more straight. I've just pulled out this X-ray to show you how, you know, the SIAM may look different, but you have to understand the SIAM picture very well. What about difficult situations? Spondylolisthesis is a difficult situation, especially a high grade scoliosis where they are curved. And you really need to take your time in something like a dysplastic spondylo or a high grade spondylo. I always do the decompression first. I find the exiting root and I palpate the pedicle from inside and I put my screw very slowly. The reason is that you got only one shot at it. If in an L5S1 dysplastic, you break the pedicle, that's the end of your operation. You can't do a reduction after that. So you have to treat it with great respect. Scoliosis as well is a different story, but scoliosis is going to be more of thoracic. So Amit Sharma will tell you more about it. And take your time. There's no rush. Nobody gives you an award for finishing fast. You know, you the patient wants a good surgery, not a fast surgery. The only one who may give you an award is an anesthetist, but don't bother too much about them. Study your imaging very well and intra-op x-rays as well. Complications, of course, we know the complications. I think we'll take that in the question answer session, but we know all of these. Root injury, dural injury, vessel injury. Pull out, cut through in case there are questions. Screw breakage is more, screw breakage early in the first 3 months would be an issue with the implant. But after that is a, after that is an issue with the surgery or the union. So it's gone into a non-union or the biomechanical principles are not you know, followed. That's when you get a breakage. And screw prominence in thin patients, especially in the thoracic spine. If you put in the screws, initially there is some swelling, soft tissue, edema and all. But later on when it settles down and the muscles atrophy because of lack of movement, that's when these screws become very prominent and causes a problem. So screw perforation is an issue if you take only lateral x-rays and look at this. But if you look at the AP, most of these screws are out. And in the thoracic spine, they can be quite dangerous and you know even kill your patient sometimes. Osteoporotic spine would be another topic. This is my last slide, Vishal, in case I'm running late. So
please continue.
You can use cancellous or differential threads in osteoporotic spine. You can use fenestrated screws through which you inject cement. Or you can use HA-coated screws where they say there is a bone ingrowth. So I'm not going to talk about the details of this because these are more company-driven and I personally don't believe in that. And that's that now. In case...
Thank you, Dr. Sameer. I think it was a very elaborate and elucid talk about how to get intraosseous placement of lumbar screws. Anything in special you would want to mention about the sacral screws? We spoke about sacral screws having a very different kind of hold, purchase is required. How do we ensure that a sacral screw get the adequate convergence and adequate cortical, bicortical purchase?
So sacral, exactly. So as he pointed out, in sacral screw, there are two important differences from a lumbar screw. One is that it has to be convergent. And I think I should make a presentation on sacral screw once for, as I keep saying, next pandemic, sacral screw. So sacral screw, one is it should be convergent. The reason for it being convergent is that it is a reverse reason actually. So as I've told you, the lumbar screws have to be unicortical because a bicortical screw can damage the vascular structures in front. Whereas a lumbar, whereas a sacral screw has to be bicortical. The reason is that the sacrum is a very hollow kind of thing. It's like almost like a hollow box. And unless and until, you know, you perforate the opposite cortex or the promontory specifically, preferably, as is shown in this lower slide of his. This slide is being seen by everyone, right?
Yes. Yeah,
you can see the promontory there. So it's a slightly angled screw and it hits the promontory. So unless it hits that, it doesn't have a very good hold. And because, especially in a longer construct, if you do L4, 5, S1, everything comes on that S1 screw and that can just pull out. So therefore, you need bicortical. Now, when it is bicortical, why does it have to be convergent? And just show on the upper X-ray. Aha. You can see it has to be convergent because the at S1, L5, S1 is the bifurcation. And the bifurcation of the vessel would be over there. So in the middle, there is no vessel. But if you put it straight, there are two problems. One is the vessel for the bifurcation and the other one is the lumbar plexus. So these are the two things which you can hit if your screw is straight but bicortical. So therefore, you need to converge and do a bicortical screw. Now, how do you do it? The technique also is very is a little different. Number one is more often than not, I do tend to remove the L5 S1 facet when I'm putting the S1 screws because that gives me a very good entry. The facet is fairly large. It's forgiving. It's unlikely that you will miss the it's unlikely that you'll miss the pedicle. It's quite a huge pedicle. But you need to enter slightly laterally, decorticate. And after that, you use your probe and until you hit the anterior cortex. Once you hit the anterior cortex, what you do is you take a hammer. What I do is I take a hammer and I start gently tapping. And the sound changes as it hits. So you get tuk, 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 tuk. So that's when you know that you hit the anterior cortex and just go through it. Once you go through it, you feel it, you make sure you're perforated through. And this is one stage where you should tap the entire length. So if you're using a 6 millimeter screw, use a 5 millimeter tap, but don't just tap the beginning. Tap the entire length because you have to tap the cortex as well. And the reason for tapping the far cortex is this. If you put your screw and you go round and round and it hits the anterior cortex and doesn't go through, it rotates in the same place. If it rotates in the same place, the threads cut out and you get what is known as a GFR screw. Ghumat Firat Rahat. So it just rotates in the same place And that's the end of your screw. I mean, you are literally screwed at that point, because then you have to put in a bigger screw and a longer screw. It becomes a big mess. So please don't be lazy. Do this thing of tuck, 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 tuck. Find the hole, tap it through, right? Tap it through and put in the correct length of screw. So that is as far as the sacral screw. So sacral screw is a bit of a thing. There is a rescue, which is known as the ala screw, which I have never in my life done. So you can put a screw in the ala of the sacrum, but I have never ever done it.
Right. Also, Dr.
Sameer, sorry, can I just finish? The show the lower right one, the promontory screw.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the promontory screw is very important. I will tell you why. There is one more reason for the promontory screw being involved. Number one, it has got a very good hold in that. The other thing is, look at the direction or the angle of that screw. So if you have an L5 screw, you can have a good gap between the two, or they can be parallel for you to put your rod. Whereas suppose you had this L5S1 listhesis over there, and you put in a screw like this, and you put in a screw at L5, then their heads collide. There is no place between the two for you to put the rod, and it's very difficult to work. And I learned this, especially if you do Steffi, which I used to do, the posterior, those outliers used to actually cross over. It was very difficult to even put a plate. So when you do this, your screws are parallel, and you can easily pull your L5 back. Yes. Thank you, Vishal. You're really doing a great job of illustrating what I'm saying. So I think you have also done Steffi screws in your life.
Yes, once.
Once, my God. I have done lots of Steffi. I mean, lots and lots and lots of Steffi screws.
Yeah. Ajay, two questions here, Doug, that come immediately to my mind, Dr. Sameer, for everyone.
Yeah.
One is, do you think that for sacrum to get this convergence, it usually is difficult because of the iliac crest here?
Yeah. So if it's a low lying,
what is the tip on that?
It's a low lying. If it's a low lying thing or a thin patient, sometimes, you know, low lying S1. Or a thin patient, it is sometimes difficult. I don't have any specific tip on it. You have to just try your best. Unless if you have a specific idea, you can tell me. I don't have a specific trick.
Right. So another very important question is, now very often we see that our screws in the sacrum, they look that as if they are in the middle. They are over here on a C-arm. Hmm. And still we are able to feel a bicortical. Like here we see, is it the C-arm image of touching the anterior cortex that is important? Like here or
no,
here?
No, the feel is more important.
Exactly. Yeah. Feel is why important. Why do you say so? I mean,
No, because you may not have gone exactly to the midline. It may be a more steep sort of thing. Yeah, you may be somewhere there. And the heart, it may be more heart-shaped. Right? It may be more heart-shaped.
Right.
So don't, because the last thing you want to do is hit a vessel. Your patient will die because you will not realize what's happening.
Right. Yeah. Any special, like there are situations, there are surgeons who mention about different entry points for lumbar screws like these. Anything in specific that one particular lumbar entry point one should use? There are transection method, there are Roy Camille method. Any specific?
No, so Roy Camille are more straight screws. Okay. And I use this the junction of the three, lateral border of facet, midpoint of transverse process and pars interarticulares. So the pink one, in the previous picture, the pink one.
So I think, thank you, Dr. Sameer. It has been really wonderful to have you around.
Roy Camille was at a time when they didn't recognize upper facet injury. So that is the problem.
Right. I think the few tips that we have just got to get absolutely wonderful intraosseous placement is one, absolutely wonderful exposure. Your bones have to look like bones. There have to be no soft tissue attached to it, except the upper capsule, which has to be preserved. But the lower capsule, which is in between the two screws, has to be burnt across. Your facet joint has to be seen. Your superior facet has to be seen. Both the transverse process tips have to be seen all the way from one side of the tip to the other side of the tip. It's absolutely mandatory in initial days to please strip off muscles in a way that you're doing subperiosteal dissection, reduce the bleeding, reduce the timing, and try to look at the bull's eye, the pedicle under C-arm guidance, and initial few cases, try to have a lateral entry point and get good convergence and try to have a bigger incision rather than a smaller one. Struggling in a smaller incision can really have you a lateral entry point and a lateral placement, or a medial entry point and medial placement. And that's why one, exposure is very important. Identification of the right entry point. It is 70% job already done. And then what comes is absolutely your feel that you go through with the help of your owl, with the help of your feeler. Remember, it is all cancellous bone once you're taken down the entry point. And in cancellous, it's just a cakewalk. It just walks through, it guides you. And any sudden jerk or any force that you have to do means you're perforating through the cortical margin, which you should avoid it. Now, Dr. Sameer, intraoperatively, if you tend to feel that I have felt that while feeling it out, I have got a perforation. Hmm. What is your step from there? Like you have gone in your owl there, and with the help of your feeler, you feel that there is a some perforation medially. So would you right then and there change the direction, or you would check it on the C-arm and rely more on C-arm to see? Because sometimes feeling may not
see. Basically, you know, one thing is definite. You must if you're in trouble, you must seek help of anything and everything which can help you at that point. So you can't say that I'm a tiger and I will just do the feel. No, you see where you are out. You put in your KY. It's better to then put in a ball tip probe. You know, ball tip probe, because it tells you where is the tip. And rather than put a KY, which is just a sharp thing, you put in the ball tip probe. You know, forget everything else, concentrate. So then your entire surgery is now going to be in making sure that screw is right. Because if you're putting four screws and one screw is wrong, your surgery is not 25% wrong. Your surgery is 50% wrong, because one side is not working. You understand? People think that char mein se ek gaya to theek hai, but you know, that doesn't matter. The other thing is, if you have one L5 and other S1 screw out, your surgery is zero, because neither of the sides has got any fixation. So right. I would put in a ball tip probe, take C-arm, use all my clues, see whether I can, then I decide, okay, is my entry point right and can I change my direction? Or do I need to have a fresh entry point to make, you know, to prevent the pedicle from blowing out or what? Usually what happens is, like, most of the time what I have had to do is take a more lateral point, doing a more convergent thing. And when I do a more convergent thing, I go slowly, converge it a lot more. And then I actually dilate the pedicle, because otherwise there'll be a blowout. So by dilating the pedicle, what do I mean? I first use a 4.5 tap, then a 5.5 tap, and then I fully use a 6.5 tap also. Fully, I will use a 6.5 tap. That's the only way that you're sure. Because if you don't use a tap, again, the pedicle can blow out when you put in the screw. And then in that tap thing you put it in, you will find that initially the pedicle may not give you a good hold, but once it enters the body, it gives you a better hold. So,
I think it's a very important message. Try to use everything that comes to you. And I will rather add to this that even your assistant sometimes may have a gut feeling that there is a perforation, and you yourself in the surgeon's ego may get carried away and may not want to accept that you have had a perforation. And sometimes you may want to say, chalta hai, nahi, nahi, chalu rehta. So that kind of thing, I think we should avoid. And even a slightest doubt that it is perforated means it is perforated. And you may want to recheck, check again, check under C-arm or with your feeler. Now, Dr. Samir, how about the tip about feeling? There are, I have seen so many of my fellows. Initially, what they do is they put in a feeler and feel the bass, and tuck, tuck, tuck noise makes them feel happy.
No. The walls have to be felt, because you can go out and out also. No? You can be completely medial and still feel the bass. You will feel the bass of the vertebra. So exactly. It is not only the tip. You have to feel all the four walls through and through. And in fact, if you want to be 100% sure, what some people do is after tapping, they again feel, because after tapping, what happens is that it is you feel the, you know, valleys and peaks. So if you feel valley and peak continuously from the base to the top, it means you are quite in. So right. If you know, early stage, you may even do that. Like, there's no, see that, like I said, there is no prizes for finishing quickly. Take your time and put the screw. That screw matters. That patient is getting only four screws in his life. You may be putting 1,000 screws in a year. So you need to make it very important. So what you do is, even after tapping, one more time you put the probe and you do that.
So one quick tip from you: in a patient with degenerative spondylolisthesis, where the listhesis vertebrae is lying anterior, what is your tip for getting hold in? Because it's one time. I mean, there is no second time in these listhesis vertebrae.
Degenerative or dysplastic?
Anything. I mean, even in a
degenerative are quite easy, because they are right in front of you. So I don't think degenerative is a problem. It's like a normal spine, actually.
Right.
The only problem with a badly degenerate spine is sometimes the facets are very, very badly degenerated. Your entry points go for a toss. If your entry points go for a toss, then your distal one, like the one which you're fusing, that is fine, because you can actually nibble out the facet and you open the facet and go through the facet. That is fine. But the upper one, which you don't want to damage, sometimes becomes challenging. And you have to make sure that you remove all the soft tissue, visualize everything well, make your best use of your skills, your anatomy, and your C-arm, all three.
Right.
Well, the dysplastic one, which has gone anteriorly, that's the problem. Because what has happened, it goes very deep, it goes anteriorly, it is angled and it is thin. So for that, like I told you, the most important thing what I do is I completely expose the exiting root and the medial border and the inferior border of the pedicle. And I actually feel the pedicle. So what I have is I have a Penfield retractor held against the pedicle. Okay. And then I start doing my entry point. So it gives me one hand Penfield and the other the entry point and the putting the thing.
Right. And what do you do usually? There are surgeons who do screws first, decompression later. There are surgeons who do decompression first, open up the dura, see the nerve roots and then put their screws. What is your protocol?
For lumbar, I do decompression first.
And thoracic, you do screws first.
Thoracic, I may do screws first. It depends on what it is. But I mean to say is that, let me say, thoracic maybe may go one way or the other. But for lumbar, I do screws first. And for cervical, always screws first.
Right. Yeah. I think this is something variable, and I'm sure the various surgeons will have their own ways of doing it.
Yeah, you have your own thing. But see, yes. The cervical one is scared of with using the sharp instruments when the dura is exposed. So right. There are always, even if I don't put the screw, which may hinder my surgery, I will drill and tap it and make sure that everything is fine. Only then do the laminectomy.
Right. And one quick last question. Now, intraoperatively, if you have found there is a burst, you feel that there is a pedicle perforation, how do you go about salvage of that burst pedicle?
No, I told you, right? I would try and see whether I need to change the entry point or the direction, whether entry point is right and direction is the problem or both is the problem. And then I will slowly put it. I will go very slow, step by step. I will take multiple C-arms. You know, if I'm wearing a lead gown and this thing, I may even do it like how you do. Oh, sorry, that reminds me. One of the good things to do is, since we are used to MIS, is that if you are doing it even open and the MIS kit is there, that is very useful, especially in the burst pedicle. So you do it open, but do it like an MIS. You put in your guide wire and slowly start putting it, and you drill and tap over the, guide wire. Then you take out everything and put a normal screw. You don't have to put a cannulated screw because you're seeing it, right?
Right.
So that,
right.
That is something. So there are a couple of revisions, needless to say, other people's revisions, which I had to do, where I had to change the direction. And I asked for the MIS set, which worked very well in that case.
Right. I think a very valuable tip that comes across. Thank you, Dr. Sameer Dalvi. We'll get back to you. Before we close on to this, Dr. Vinod Ingalalikar, sir, are you there with us, Dr. Ingalalikar, sir? Are you there with us?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very muffled, sir. We would want to understand from you, if we are not able to salvage, taking away from Dr. Dalvi, if we are not able to salvage that pedicle which is burst, is it okay to do only unilateral fixation, or you would always go one level higher up in these patients or use alternative fixation?
Level higher is necessary. You will have to go unless, you see, one-sided pedicle alone will not be strong enough for you to mobilize the patient soon. So you will have to go one level above. The other thing you could do is go even more laterally, like you go in thoracic spine, in, out, in. Similarly, right. You can, your entry point can go even more laterally, but try to get into the body. Because the entry points have been fired out, you go even more laterally. I would say enter the body on the lateral margin of the pedicle, which what we mistakenly do, you do it decidedly here.
Right.
One more point I would like to make here is in many cases of listhesis, especially, the paraspinals are very tight and contracted. These patients have persistent lordosis on stooping. So, you know, on the table, when you try to retract them, these soft tissues always push your handle and change your direction of the screws while you're putting in. So in those situations, right. I've gone simultaneously over the muscles to the point, like Sameer mentioned, MIS, I would do it, access that particular point by splitting muscles little lateral, about 2 inches lateral, and enter my tap, enter my probe, enter my screws through the muscle, over the muscle.
Right. I think it's a very valuable tip. Particularly, it comes very handy in sacrum where the fascia is up to here. When your fascia is lying all the way up to here, though you have got your this is your exposure, however, and you are not able to retract any further. So if you have all this muscle here, you can just put a small incision or a nick in the fascia, a small nick here, while you are visualizing from here. And your screw handles can run through the muscle. You don't have to really retract it, and you can run through, and you can see the tulip can be lying there. So this is a very valuable tip when the pelvis is high riding and the L4-5 is sitting inside the pelvis. I think thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Dalvi. Thank you so much, Dr.